Almighty God, look with loving mercy on your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed, to be given over to the hands of sinners, and to suffer death on the cross, who now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. John. Jesus went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to a place where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, because Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas brought a detachment of soldiers together from the chief priest and the Pharisees, and they came there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that was to happen to him, came forward and asked him,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They answered,
"Jesus of Nazareth."
Jesus replied,
"I am he."
Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them. When Jesus said to them, "I am he," they stepped back and fell to the ground. Again, he asked them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
And they said,
"Jesus of Nazareth."
Jesus answered,
"I told you that I am he. So if you are looking for me, let these men go."
This was to fulfill the word that he had spoken, "I did not lose a single one of those whom you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter,
"Put your sword back into its sheath. Am I not to drink the cup that the Father has given me?"
So the soldiers, their officer, and the Jewish soldiers arrested Jesus and bound him. First, they took him to Annas, who was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, the high priest that year. Caiaphas was the one who had advised the Jews that it was better to have one person die for the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Since that disciple was known to the high priest, he went with Jesus into the courtyard of the high priest, but Peter was standing outside at the gate. So the other disciple, who was known to the high priest, went out, spoke to the woman who guarded the gate, and brought Peter in. The woman said to Peter,
You are not also one of this man's disciples, are you?
He said,
I am not.
Now, the slaves and the soldiers had made a charcoal fire because it was cold, and they were standing around it and warming themselves. Peter also was standing in with them and warming himself. Then the high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his teaching. Jesus answered,
I have spoken openly to the world. I have always taught in the synagogues and in the temple where all the Jews come together. I have said nothing in secret. Why do you ask me? Ask those who heard what I said to them. They know what I said.
When he said this, one of the soldiers standing nearby struck Jesus on the face, saying,
Is that how you answer the high priest?
Jesus answered,
If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?
Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. They asked him,
You are not also one of the disciples, are you?
He denied it and said,
I am not.
One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, asked,
Did I not see you in the garden with him?
Again, Peter denied it, and at that moment, the cock crowed. Then they took Jesus from Caiaphas to Pilate's headquarters. It was early in the morning. They themselves did not enter the headquarters so as to avoid ritual defilement and to be able to eat the Passover. So Pilate went out to them and said,
What accusation do you bring against this man?
They answered,
If this man were not a criminal, we would not have handed him over to you.
Pilate said to them,
Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law.
The Jews replied,
We are not permitted to put anyone to death.
This was to fulfill what Jesus had said when he indicated the kind of death he was to die. Then Pilate entered the headquarters again, summoned Jesus, and asked him,
Are you the king of the Jews?
Jesus answered,
Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me?
Pilate replied,
I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?
Jesus answered,
My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here.
Pilate asked him,
So you are a king?
Jesus answered,
You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice.
Pilate asked him,
What is truth?
After he had said this, he went out to the Jews again and told them,
I find no case against him, but you have a custom that I release someone for you at the Passover. Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?
They shouted in reply,
Not this man, but Barabbas.
Now Barabbas was abandoned. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him flogged. And the soldiers wove a crown of thorns and put it on his head. And they dressed him in a purple robe. They kept coming up to him saying,
Hail, King of the Jews!
And striking him on the face, Pilate went out again and said to them,
Look, I am bringing him out to you to let you know that I find no case against him.
So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them,
Here is the man.
When the chief priest and the soldiers saw him, they shouted,
Crucify him! Crucify him!
Pilate said to them,
Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no case against him.
The Jews answered him,
We have a law,
and according to that law,
he ought to die, because he has claimed to be the Son of God.
Now when Pilate heard this, he was more afraid than ever. He entered his headquarters again and asked Jesus,
"Where are you from?"
But Jesus gave him no answer. Pilate therefore said to him,
"Do you refuse to speak to me? Do you not know that I have power to release you and power to crucify you?"
Jesus answered him,
"You would have no power over me unless it had been given to you from above. Therefore, the one who handed me over to you is guilty of the greater sin."
From then on, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out,
"If you release this man, you are no friend of the emperor. Everyone who claims to be a king sets himself against the emperor."
When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus outside and sat on the judge's bench at a place called the Stone Pavement, or in Hebrew, Gabbatha. Now it was a day of preparation for the Passover, and it was about noon. He said to the Jews,
"Here is your king."
They cried out,
Away with him! Crucify him!"
Pilate asked them,
"Shall I crucify your king?"
The chief priest answered,
We have no king but the emperor.
Then he handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross by himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, which in Hebrew is called Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus between them. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, in Latin, and in Greek. Then the chief priest of the Jews said to Pilate,
Do not write the King of the Jews, but this man said, I am King of the Jews.
Pilate answered,
"What I have written, I have written."
When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four parts, one for each soldier. They also took his tunic. Now the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top. So they said to one another,
Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it to see who will get it.
This was to fulfill what the scripture says, "They divided my clothes among themselves, and for my clothing they cast lots." And that is what the soldiers did. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother,
"Woman, here is your son."
Then he said to the disciple,
"Here is your mother."
And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home. After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, he said, in order to fulfill the scripture,
"I am thirsty."
A jar full of sour wine was standing there. So they put a sponge full of the wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the wine, he said,
"It is finished."
Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Since it was a day of preparation, the Jews did not want the bodies left on the cross during the Sabbath, especially because that Sabbath was a day of great solemnity. So they asked Pilate to have the legs of the crucified men broken and the bodies removed. Then the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once blood and water came out. He who saw this has testified so that you may also believe. His testimony is true, and he knows that he tells the truth. These things occurred so that the scripture might be fulfilled. None of his bones shall be broken. And again, another passage of scripture says, they will look on the one whom they have pierced. After these things, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, though a secret one because of his fear of the Jews, asked Pilate to let him take away the body of Jesus. Pilate gave him permission. So he came and removed his body. Nicodemus, who had at first come to Jesus by night, also came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and wrapped it with the spices in linen cloths, according to the burial custom of the Jews. Now there was a garden in the place where he was crucified, and in the garden there was a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid. And so, because it was the Jewish day of preparation and the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there. This is the gospel of the Lord. It's Friday, but Sunday is coming. Some people do not embrace that. I don't remember when I've ever felt so emotional on a Good Friday before. I had never seen this cross before because we weren't gathered together last year. And I think we would all agree we've had a tough year. But nothing like Jesus endured on the cross. When I was back in Nebraska visiting some family and being involved with some long haulers, I talked to a friend that was there, and she said something that just still puzzles me. She said, you know, I don't like Easter. I don't know if there's anybody in here that's ever said that. If so, I'd like to talk to you afterwards. I came back here, and I thought of what she said, because I looked at her, and she knew I was just puzzled. And she said, you know what I like? The only thing I like about Easter is when I think of my new little dress and my bonnet and my new little purse. And I came back and I called her. I thought maybe there was more to this story, but there wasn't. And it still makes me sad that no matter what I said or didn't say, it didn't seem to make a difference. How does that happen? And that prayer was for me not to be judgmental in my mind or in my heart, because I don't know anything about what her footsteps have been in life. But obviously, she doesn't want to deal with the pain. The pain of Good Friday. And if we don't deal with the pain of what happened on Good Friday, how can we grow spiritually? If we avoid the pain in our lives, we're not going to grow spiritually. We can pretend to tiptoe through the tulips with our little dresses and our little hats and our little purses, but where is the growth in that? We're grown-up people. So I'm asking you today, can you feel the pain today and know that it has a purpose in your life? Whether you've lost loved ones, whether you've been ill, whether you've gone through separations, have you been able to face that pain, or did you do like she does? Some people deaden the pain of their lives with alcohol, drugs, work, shopping, you name it. And I'm asking each of us today to pray that away, to experience the emotion of Good Friday, knowing that this isn't the end. This is not the end. Jesus sacrificed his life for you and for me. The Romans beat him. They nailed him to the cross. I can't even imagine the pain. I remember the first time I experienced the pain of thinking of his mother at the foot of the cross and Jesus saying, "Now she's your mother." The abandonment that he must have felt and she must have felt. They tortured him until he died for you and for me. What are we willing to do in our life? Are we willing to face the pain and grow spiritually? Are we willing to make a sacrifice? I came across a little card the other day. I think I can find it in here now that I've moved all my things. And this little card says, from 1 John 3:16, we understand what love is when we realize that Christ gave his life for us. That must mean we give our lives for other believers. Are we willing to make the sacrifices that that takes? In Matthew 25, Jesus tells us to take up our cross, to take up our cross and follow Jesus. It says in there, "Truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me." Jesus is asking us to serve others, not just to serve ourselves. And you know, serving others sometimes means a painful time. We are called to embrace the pain and grow beyond it. Are we giving ourselves to serve others? Is this church giving itself to serve others? We heard yesterday, if you were at the Maundy Thursday service, Pastor Lowell talked about our church council working on a long-term plan for this church. I guess it hasn't been done since 2015. To try to look to the future and what is it we need to do. And we know we do a lot of things for our community. Pandavia, the Navajo, the list goes on of what we do for others. But are we being called to do more? You know, I always said, Jesus died on that cross. I don't have to climb up there and die. But Jesus is calling me to do something with my life. What is the purpose of our life other than just to be Christian and say we believe? If we believe, what is our commitment? In Galatians 6, verse 14, it says, "May I never boast of anything except the cross of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, by which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world." Jesus died for you and me. I cannot say that too many times today. And we don't need to boast about what we're doing. That's not what we're called to do. I've never seen a congregation with so many people that are doing so much. You know, and I was touched this week because I was able to do a celebration of life for Marguerite Johnson, and many of you knew her. And ever since I've been in the ministry, I have to confess, I have never been more inspired by a woman than I was Marguerite and her humble family. Her husband used to be a pastor here. Many of you probably knew him, Murray. And the family is just a beautiful family. And of course, I connected with them because many of them are farm families, and they still farm. And as I visited with them and listened to their sharing of their memories, I realized how this woman has changed so many lives. She was 93 when she passed away. She must have been a brilliant woman. She taught foreign languages and she taught immigrants, and I knew that. She taught immigrants to speak English rather than just talked about them. She helped immigrants in a way that they could be productive. She lived at Royal Oaks, and some of those employees learned English from her. What a beautiful thing that she would do that. Engage with people rather than talking about people. And truly, when I grow up next time, I want to be more like Marguerite. If the Spirit of God possesses us through his death, there will be a transformation of our soul. Joe Anderson suggested something that I think is an awesome thing, that we have crosses on our fellowship wall. And when I was at Bethany Lutheran, the church that I was ordained in and Pastor Lowell was ordained in, there was a big wall with crosses. And I was just so excited. And the other day, Joe came into my office and look what she brought me to put on the fellowship hall. And today I'm going to lay this cross on the table, and I'm going to invite you during this Easter season to lay the cross that you want to give to the wall of memory. Her husband, Don, made this cross out of, I don't know if you can see it, but it's my favorite colors, stained glass. And it means a lot to them. And she's not giving something that doesn't mean a lot to them. And that's what I think Jesus is asking us to do, to sacrifice. Not to just give from our abundance and, you know, but to really dig deep and say, what is it that Jesus is asking me to do today? I prayed a lot before I decided to give this cross. This cross was painted by a dear friend who has since died from dementia. And I lost track of her because when somebody has dementia and they move, it's hard. And I got online. That's the first time I did that. Her picture was online because she did die. And that made it even harder for me to think about giving this cross to the wall. When I looked on the back, it said, painted by Marjorie Balmer, 2003. She taught other people how to paint China. And it, of course, has for Judith Rainforth, has ordained 9-21-03. I'm going to lay this cross down along with the cross Joe gave. And I'm laying this cross down as a testimony that I gave up an old life. I gave up an old life that day in a new way. And I encourage you to be reborn every day. It's not a once in a lifetime thing. I wasn't reborn and started speaking in tongues. Sometimes it might sound like it, but I'm not. What is it that you're willing to sacrifice? And this is just a thing. This isn't, you know, but it means a lot to me. What is the purpose of your day? I hope this Holy Week you've found new purpose in your life. And this year, the year of the pandemic, has given us an opportunity to find out more about the importance. And I hope you've taken the time of silence to pray, to meditate, to be fully present with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And if you've lost a loved one, because I know some of you have, I've come close to it. I've watched my three sons be transformed with the Holy Spirit as their dad came very close to dying and is now a long hauler. And my sons are stepping up in a way I never thought possible. So we do not get to where we are in our lives without facing some pain. If there is anybody that can get through this life without pain, I want to talk to them. And I also want to talk to my friend more about why she doesn't like Easter. Because there's time beyond today when Jesus died on the cross. And today we're going to be closing our service after we have our prayers and stuff with one of my favorite pieces of music, Jesus, Remember Me. And if you read in Luke, you will know those words came from the criminal on the cross who just before he took his last breath, he said, Jesus, remember me. And that's what I hope for each of us, is that we can pray that as we're singing it today. Jesus, remember me, just as the criminal did. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to lay these crosses down. And it's a testimony, the love, the gratitude, the sacrifice that Jesus has made for you and for me. And for me, one of the bigger sacrifices was the day I was ordained in 2003. So let us pray. Gracious and loving God, thank you. Help us to be transformed by your Spirit. Help us to live our lives transformed. May our souls continue to be transformed so that we as individuals and a church are willing to face the life you have called us to and to grow spiritually and continue to be your hands and feet. We pray this all in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Oh,
Let us pray for our bishops, for our pastors, for our servant leaders of the church, and for all the people of God. Almighty and eternal God, your Spirit guides the church and makes it holy. Strengthen and uphold our bishops, pastors, other ministers, and lay leaders. Keep them in health and safety for the good of the church, and help each of us in our various vocations to do faithfully the work to which you have called us. We ask through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for those preparing for baptism. Almighty and eternal God, you continue to bless the church. Increase the faith and understanding of those preparing for baptism. Give them new birth as your children and keep them in the faith and communion of your holy church. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for our siblings who share our faith in Jesus Christ. Almighty and eternal God, you give your church unity. Look with favor on all who follow Jesus, your Son. Make all the baptized one in the fullness of faith, and keep us united in the fellowship of love. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for the Jewish people, the first to hear the word of God. Almighty and eternal God, long ago you gave your promise to Abraham and your teaching to Moses. Hear our prayers that the people you called and elected as your own may receive the fulfillment of the covenant's promises. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Let us pray for those who do not share our faith in Jesus Christ. Almighty and eternal God, gather into your embrace all those who call out to you under different names. Bring an end to interreligious strife and make us more faithful witnesses of the love made known to us in your Son. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for those who do not believe in God. Almighty and eternal God, you created humanity so that all may long to know you and find peace in you. Grant that all may recognize the signs of your love and grace in the world and in the lives of Christians, and gladly acknowledge you as the one true God. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for God's creation. Almighty and eternal God, you are the creator of a magnificent universe. Hold all the worlds in the arms of your care and bring all things to fulfillment in you. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for those who serve in public office. Almighty and eternal God, you are the champion of the poor and oppressed. In your goodness, give wisdom to those in authority so that all people may enjoy justice, peace, freedom, and a share in the goodness of your creation. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for those in need. Almighty and eternal God, you give strength to the weary and new courage to those who have lost heart. Heal the sick, comfort the dying, give safety to travelers, free those unjustly deprived of liberty, and deliver your world from falsehood. hunger, and disease. Hear the prayers of all who call on you in any trouble, that they may have the joy of receiving your help in their need. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. And together we pray the prayer our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now we have the presentation of the cross. Behold the life-giving cross on which was hung the salvation of the whole world. Behold the life-giving cross on which was hung the salvation of the whole world.
O come, let us worship him.
Behold the life-giving cross on which was hung the salvation of the whole world.
O come, let us worship him.
We adore you, O Christ, and we bless you.